I'm so excited about this, I can't tell you.
Standing here now?
Yeah, it's just... I can't believe it. It was such a dream. About a year ago, it really was a dream. And I was so jealous of people, the people who were supposed to open it. And this is just fantastic.
Compared to other places you've played, you know, you've played many venues. Can you get a feel for somewhere when there's nobody in it?
Yeah, you can, absolutely. This is going to be a fantastic, fantastic venue. I mean, obviously, as a sports venue, it's custom built, you know, but it's definitely the right shape for a party, do you know what I mean?
It's going to be a party?
Definitely, absolutely.
OK, you're going to be playing up this end,
yes.
We've been assured.
I'm quite interested to know, actually, exactly where the stage, where my spot on stage, I bet I'm right over the goal.
Well, I hope so. So you're going to be, like, sort of here, but a bit further up?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
OK, so what happens? You walk out on stage, this is what you see, it's full. What's the first thing you think?
You're a lucky bastard. Do you know what I mean? It really is.
Are you conscious about anything, or are you so nervous and excited? Are you in the moment?
Well, to be honest, in London, I'm totally in the moment. My London fan base is so amazing that they lift everything to just that. You know, because it's my hometown, I suppose.
But you've also got to, I mean, you've got to sort of temper your performance, haven't you? It's got to have a rhythm to it, it's got to have its peaks and its troughs.
That was one of the good things about starting the tour a month before, you know, Wembley, is because there's plenty of time to make sure I get the rhythm of the stage, because it's actually, it was quite shocking when I first went out on the stadium, on this stadium tour, I'd forgotten just quite how much ground you have to cover, you know.
Yeah, and sing.
And sing.
And not be out of breath.
And I'm not a young boy. And so that was a bit of a shock the first night. I realised how hard the work was going to be. But actually, within three or four shows, you get a rhythm going. And I think, hopefully, will be one of the best shows of my career.
Wow. George, you are the first musical artist to play at the brand new Wembley. Did they call you, or did you call them?
Oh, I called them, definitely. Definitely. It just occurred to me last year when I heard that everything was going to be late and that those gigs last year, I think it was Bon Jovi, The Stones and Robbie, I think, were supposed to play here last summer. And when I worked out that they weren't going to be able to, I thought, well, there's a possibility you could actually sneak in there next year. So I approached the board and said, you know, I'd love to be the first and please keep me in mind, you know. And they came down to the shows at Earl's Court and obviously decided I was worthy.
So the only way you had to pitch for it?
Oh, yeah.
And you were happy to do that?
Yeah, I was perfectly happy to do that. I'm not really big on auditioning, but I was perfectly happy to do that. And I knew that, you know, I was very proud of the show, so I was happy for them to come down and judge me.
So how does it work? Have you hired this place for a do? Is that how it works?
That's how it works, yeah. You rent the building, yeah.
Some function room.
Yeah, it's quite a big function room. It's not the cheapest function room in the world either, and neither should it be. Look at it, it's amazing.
As we sit here 2 weeks before the show is going to happen, how prevalent in your mind is it now? How often do you think about it?
All the time. All the time. Because I think about the show a lot anyway, because in the first few weeks of a tour, you never really know how things are going to go until you've done it a few times in front of an audience. So you're constantly, the idea was definitely to change this show all the way through, you know, to be, keep working on the standard of it all the way through the tour. But obviously, you know, Wembley, I mean, I'm just so thrilled. This is just such a perfect, perfect situation for me, you know.
Appearances at Wembley, OK? You've played Wembley more times than most England footballers and you've often had a better time than they've experienced, and so have your fans. You do tend to score pretty well. Live Aid 1985, What do you remember of Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me?
Other than the fact that I look like Rolf Harris. Because for some reason I decided to go a little bit heavier on the beard. I think I decided it didn't look... you couldn't see it enough on the TV, so I grew it a bit longer. And I did, I looked like Rolf Harris in a leather jacket. It was dreadful. I can't find for the right romantic line. I remember much more about the day and the event than I do about performing there. Although I suppose it was my first big solo performance on television, I guess.
So, what is the George Michael pre-concert tour anxiety dream?
Well, it's always the same. It's always that I'm suddenly on stage and no one's rehearsed anything. It's always the same. And I don't ever turn up with no trousers on or anything like that in these dreams, but Andrew used to say he had a recurring dream that Bruce Springsteen was in the audience and that Bruce Springsteen wanted to come up on stage with Wham. But when he got up there, by the time Bruce got up there, everyone had left. That was Andrew's nightmare. But mine was just simply that, you know, I wasn't ready. I didn't know what songs I was supposed to be singing. So that's my recurring nightmare.
And 2 weeks to go, how's that going? Is it more training to go or...?
I think maybe there are still a few decisions to be made in terms of the order and the three songs that will go out live, because I have to decide on those. But really, the set list, I would imagine, will probably be set within the next week, and then by 2 weeks' time, the whole thing will be ready to go. We'll know exactly how it's going to go.
And who's the most important person in the build-up to a show? Is it your trainer or your tailor?
Oh, God, my trainer. Unfortunately, I don't actually have a tailor. I don't actually have a tailor. But my trainer has been working me out for the last 2 years, and at the moment it's every day. Not really a strong workout, just keeping me limber and you know, making sure that, that you know, as an old man, I get through the next
couple of months.
Not
that old yet, George. Tonight, we are at Wembley Stadium, which is filling up by the second for what promises to be an extraordinary and fitting first for this fabulous venue. We're going to take a break now, but still to come, we'll be looking back at more highlights from George's stunning 25-year live career, including performances from some of the most spectacular events to take place at the old Wembley Stadium. Plus, there'll be more from our chat with the man himself. He sold more than 85 million records with 11 UK and 6 US number one singles. He's one of the most celebrated British recording artists of all time. And tonight, George Michael will make history by becoming the first musical performer to appear at the new Wembley Stadium. Expect a massive party and an incredible show when we give you live coverage of this historic moment. Do you need your fans?
Of course, you need people, as a musician, you need people to tell you, you need people to respond to what you're doing and know that they like it. So you need an audience, absolutely, yes.
Do you need to perform?
I think probably I've needed to perform a lot more than I've wanted to admit, and I haven't performed for many, many, many years, and I think it's been something that I've not done through fear, and it's a shame, because fear, all it does is waste time, really. I'm delighted that having decided to do it again, it's gone so well, and it makes me realise I probably should have done it a long time ago, but, you know, you can only do what you're capable of at the time, can't you?
And are you better now than you ever have been?
I think so. I like to think so, yeah. I mean, I think it's a way better show than I've ever been before, yeah.
Next, it was Nelson Mandela's birthday. Mm-hmm. And you were booked as part of the entertainment for that. Mm-hmm. For Mr. Mandela, you chose to sing Sexual Healing. Mm-hmm. A strange, interesting choice for a huge stadium. Would that be a brave... Is it a brave choice, would you say, or...?
I don't know why I did that, actually. I've no idea. I've no idea why I chose most of the covers that I did in the 80s. They're all good songs, but I don't really know why I chose them.
But once again, you did all right. Would you say that was a good performance? So far, you're not happy with Live Aid. You weren't quite happy with One the Final. Were you happy with that one?
Yes, I was happy with that one, yes, I'd say, yeah. Baby, I can't take it much longer. It's getting stronger and stronger. And when I get that feel, I want sexual healing. Sexual healing. Makes me feel so fine. And did you meet Mr. Mandela on the day? Well, he was still in prison.
Oh, was he?
Yes.
So he wasn't there.
It was kind of the point of singing.
Oh, Jesse Jackson was there. All right, OK.
Yes.
All right, I apologise.
Keep up, Chris.
All right. Now, George, for me, your best performance at Wembley, but that's probably because it's the only one I actually saw live.
Oh, really? You
yeah.
were there?
It's 1992, the Freddie Mercury tribute concert. Mm-hmm. Now, he was a pretty good live performer.
It was he was one of the ultimate performers. In terms of charisma, there are very few people that can stand up to Freddie Mercury. There are some people that you can honestly look at and believe that that was what they were meant to do. He was such an unusual and original talent.
Now, that night, the Freddie Mercury tribute concert, there were a lot of nervous performers backstage because they had to sort of, not emulate him, but they had to try and recreate what he did for a living and sing some of his songs. Mm. What was it like backstage for the artists?
I think everyone was a bit overwhelmed by what they had to do because as a vocalist, he had such a range, and he wrote things that would take him from right in the bottom of his range to the very top, which was well beyond most people's. So I think it was quite scary for everyone. I mean, I rehearsed for a week. I was the only person. I was, like, there at school a week before with Brian and John and Roger, and I was literally there every day for a week because I was just not going to get this wrong.
Now, in typical George Michael style, you gave yourself an exceptionally hard time by picking a really, really difficult song, Somebody to Love.
Yeah, it's a tough song, yeah.
I mean, you are George Michael, so you're quite good at singing, but even for you...
I don't know if I chose it. I have a feeling they asked me to sing that one.
Oh, no, that's a bit...
Well, I did, yeah. I thought, how on earth am I going to do that? And obviously, I had to dodge some of the notes.
Did you?
Yeah, I dodged some of those. Yeah, there's a couple of falsetto notes in there that I didn't go for. I would never go for the falsetto notes that I went for. I mean, that was 15 years ago, but my God, I wouldn't, on live television, try and hit that high note that I do. I would never have the guts to do that. But live to however many millions of people that was, yeah, that's probably the bravest note I ever hit, yeah. And I was so honoured. And there's a shot in that piece of film where the crowd have done something and you see Brian's face, and Brian is so obviously delighted with that moment. That made me feel proud.
Everything She Wants, Young Guns, Wham Rap, Club Tropicana and Careless Whisper were only a fraction of the pop smashes penned by George in the 80s. Stay here when after the break George opens up and talks to us about Wham, and we take an exclusive look at some unseen footage from the biggest gig of 1986. Let's talk about Wembley Stadium 1986 and Wham the final, mm-hmm. Right? A huge statement, pretty irreversible, mm-hmm. OK. What did you think at the time of that statement?
I think I was proud that we did what we said we would do. We, you know, when we talked about it as 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, with our big master plan, of course, that no one knew about.
Was the one, really?
There really was. It was completely naive, but it was a plan, you know.
What was the plan again, you know, in 12 words?
In 12 words. I know, the plan was to become the biggest act in the world and then piss off, really.
And pop.
Yeah.
Literally.
That was the idea, because I think we both saw it as an apprenticeship of sorts for me, you know? And we knew there'd be a point where the two of us together would not, you know, we wouldn't be fresh from school, we wouldn't have that same impact on one another, and there would be a point where the essence of what the group was about would be pointless, you know, would become kind of a parody. And I think that we stopped at a point where that self-parody hadn't had a chance to develop. So I was very proud that we did that, and I was very proud of the number of people who wanted to come and see it, because apparently we could have played for 12 nights, but there had to, it had to be just one night. It had to be one goodbye, you know. Somebody told me
the day itself, people still talk about it. They were at one the final, OK? Can you describe it briefly for us, the beginning, the middle and the end?
Well, I seem to remember the beginning of it. I seem to remember Elton had a paddling pool out the back of Wembley, which was a lot less glamorous than this new building is, obviously. In the mid-'80s, it was pretty cheap and cheerful around the back of, you know, around the back of the stage. And Elton had set up his own little area with a paddling pool, which was quite funny, and he bought me... he bought me a three-wheeler, like a Reliant Robin, and I think put my name in the window. I can't remember. But anyway, I seem to remember that early on. And I remember the show itself very sketchily, because it was so huge. The event was so huge, and it had to be right. I remember very little about it other than getting through the last three numbers when I'd torn a ligament in my ankle, because I was wearing these ridiculous kind of cowboy boots, and did a little jump, landed badly and did that with my foot. So actually the footage of the last two or three songs from the final, I'm actually stomping around on this torn ligament and it's gone completely numb, which is how I got through it. And then when I got home, it went...
So what time did you get home that night?
After the big party at the Hippodrome. So 80s. I think I got home about 3 o'clock. Something like that.
So not that late, really, considering you did the concert here.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean... that wasn't when I went to bed. That was just when I got home.
Gotcha.
With many other people. I arrived home with many other people. It was a wonderful day because the audience was absolutely amazing. They were so up for it and everyone was dressed in their summer thing. It was a beautiful day. But the actual show looks, I think, what we'd call rinky-dink now, you know? It really looks like a tiny show in this big, big stadium. Whereas, you know, what we're going to see...
You've learnt. You've evolved.
Well, you know, and that's what goes into life of, you know, shows now. People expect a huge show. But in those days, it was... They thought they were lucky because the curtain fell at the beginning and had the big final thing.
That was enough.
That was enough. That was special effects enough.
Yeah.
Good day. Thank you very much. Thank you for the last 4 years.
Do I get to ask you why you're not wearing any socks?
Well, I just forgot them.
See, you know, how am I supposed to look at you professionally when
you've got no socks on? I do apologise.
George's 25 Live Tour is his first global tour in 15 years. In the last 9 months, it has visited 18 countries and played to 1 million people. In fact, the millionth person is right here tonight, and I think it could be Crookie, our cameraman. Now, someone has been lucky enough to follow George on his journey to the biggest show of them all, right here at Wembley Stadium.
Thank you.
hugely expensive show. We've got something like 40-odd trucks, 200 people working on the whole thing. It's not the way to make money, but it's definitely the way I feel that I want to say thank you to people. I want it to be a show that they never forget, and I think we've created that.
This is the biggest stage I've ever worked with, and the most amount of people. We're timing ourselves backwards from the start of the show. Rolly's going in to do a massage and a stretch.
We're all to deadlines now, so it's just a matter of getting the boss ready for the show.
I'm Ash.
And I'm wardrobe mistress.
Make sure everything's nice and clean, and pressed and ready for the show, and then we make everyone look gorgeous.
We've got half an hour before George has got to be on stage, so we're just last final minutes of things.
Welcome to George's dressing room.
Couch, cushions, lots of candles. We always have roses on the rider, but we also get local flowers as well.
A massive TV unit. Probably if they blow a speaker on stage, we might be able to use this on stage. It's very powerful. This is the catering area. And a very, very lovely, lovely bathroom.
15 minutes!
Done a bit, so massage over, a bit of a stretch as well. Build him up a bit, and looking good.
So the wait is almost over. We've seen George perform at some of the biggest gigs of all time in the old Wembley. After the break, we thought we were going to see him blow the roof off the new Wembley. But it seems, as with all stadiums these days, security is extra tight. And even if your face is literally on the ticket, if your name's not down, you're not coming in. Fingers crossed, George manages to blag his way into the venue in time for his own show.
Sorry, I know I'm a mile away, and that is not George Michael.
It's fantastic, isn't that fantastic?
George
will be with you in 10. Amen. 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 You got it, but the thing is, when you look like that, it does sound, suddenly starts to sound like, hey, men.
Backstage where George Michael is waiting to go out and perform to over 75,000 screaming fans. It's been 7 years since the residents of Wembley and the surrounding areas heard the unforgettable sounds of a high-octane concert. So the roof's already open. Let's turn the speakers up and musically christen the new Wembley for the first time. This is George Michael.
Take me to
table, baby.
Spinning that wheel for me.
Got a thing about danger. An angel came and watched you on the
fire. Everybody takes their chances these days. Oh yeah, we're standing in the rain.
Baby love, in the dark will not accept this as a part of my life. I will not live in fear of what they
congratulations to Hayley. The other thing I want to say again, because I know I said it to you once already today, but it has to be said on camera. For the most amazing, amazing, God-given 25 years, I thank you all. Is the most important word in the world right now. Don't let anyone take this away from you. Let me see you. See your hands. Hear your voices. First heard when I think I was about 13 years old, and ambitious little bastard that I was already, it made me think, if it ever happens for me, I'm not going to be out there at 65 in Vegas or somewhere similar. I'm going to get out while the going's good. I remember thinking that. This is called Idol. To the very bottom, because they made him and they'll waste him. And I don't believe that I want to watch them. As the 50s shifted out of gear. Whoa, he was an idol then. Now he's an idol here. But his face has changed. Oh, it's not the same no more. And I have to say, yeah, that I like the way his music sounded before. He was tight-assed, walking on smoking glass, highly prized in the wallet size. Number one crush in a schoolgirl's eyes. Won't end in the depths of your despair. You went from lamé suits, oh, right down to tennis shoes, to peanuts, from the lion's share. Thank you.